Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to this meeting of the Cemetery Board.
Fifth floor edition.
Yeah, I went to the wrong room to start with. Even though it was clearly on the agenda, my bad. I'm Dan Shapiro, as chair, Rosanna was out as designee.
I am Chris Wiles, representing Attorney Eric Schneiderman.
Paul Ambrose, representing Commissioner Howard Zucker of the Department of Health.
Louis Polishuk, Director, Division of Cemeteries.
Chester Butkowitz, Assistant Director, Division of Cemeteries.
Mike Seelman, Senior Investigator, Division of Cemeteries.
Brendan Stanton, Investigator, Division of Cemeteries.
Dan Green, Investigator, Division of Cemeteries.
Tony Malillo, Counsel to the Cemetery Board.
Welcome. Well, why don't we get right into it? Has everybody had an opportunity to review the minutes?
Yes.
Questions, comments, changes, amendments?
On Warwick Cemetery land sale, 702G12, motion was made, seconded, and unanimously adopted.
Yes.
Indeed.
Very good. All right.
And in the Bedford Union Cemetery, the last sentence, concerns of council were addressed regarding number of grave spaces to be developed, future sales, and assurance that prior and current owners of land to be purchased were not affiliated with the cemetery or funeral director. Just adding the words assurance now. Other than that, minor edits that I could give you.
I had something under the vandalism report. In the recitation of the board's concerns, I just changed it to make a little more for clarity's sake. And I have it written here, but I'll read it out loud. The board was informed that the warranty provided by a monument dealer excludes vandalism or acts of nature. The board expressed concern that such exclusions should not apply to heathen due to frost. And then it went on. Yeah, I'll give it to you. As it currently read,
Okay.
And that's it. Any additional comments or questions?
None.
Motion?
I'll move to adopt the minutes.
One more change.
One more.
Mark Patterson is with DOS.
Right, correct.
I'm sure Mark will appreciate that.
We would welcome him, but.
Thank you. Care to second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you.
Oh, shoot. Wait, do I have Paul's too? Where's this?
I don't have a legislation book.
Bring it, Tony. What's happened? What's important?
You sent it.
Tony.
I did, right? Okay. Yeah. Oh, that's right, because I forgot we had a prior date and. Okay, good. Thank you, Ted.
Oh, you have it.
Good covering for me. All right. Changes are in bold and highlighted. There's been some movement on some bills. Let's see if I want to highlight any of the highlighted ones. Penal law. Some of these are just really penal law provisions.
Mm-hmm.
The bill dealing with the tax issue has shown up. There was an issue raised about whether sales of goods and services are taxable or tax exempt, and this bill seeks to address that by making it clear that they ought to be tax exempt. You can amend the tax law. This is number 20 on the list. And then I added some funeral home bills under items of interest. They don't directly affect us, but they might be of interest. So, not too much action.
Okay. Tony, I have a question. 21.
Yes.
How is workers' compensation law related to a maximum charge? I didn't follow that.
That's a reasonable question. It made sense when I looked at the bill, but based on my own summary, I can't recall the reasoning on that.
To be determined at a future date.
Charges.
You want to throw us an email?
Yeah.
I'll clarify. Is less than correct on that?
Shall not be, I think the wording's correct.
Maximum charge shall not be less than $12,000?
Right. Yeah, let me, when we see this next month, there'll be more clarity in the description.
All right.
Is that one house or two houses?
That's a one house bill.
Okay. All right. You all done?
That's it.
Okay. Louis?
Two things. Number one, break the good news. We have had extremely well-attended sessions on our new financial reporting form and anything else people wanted to ask in Binghamton, Syracuse, Albany, Hopog, in no particular order. We had to reschedule our Buffalo meeting, which was scheduled for last week, because Buffalo, although it was rather tropical for Buffalo standards, they were still expecting snow at a rate of an inch an hour, and we thought that us people who weren't from Buffalo might find that a little difficult. So we are rescheduled for April 6th. Obviously, anyone in the Buffalo area who needs an extension, since the report's due March 31st, will be entitled to get one. Just call us. And we'll be having it on April 6th at the Wendt Center, which is the genealogy center at Forest Lawn Cemetery. That's the good news.
Okay.
The bad news is that we did have an incident of vandalism, of cemetery vandalism in Rochester, a Jewish cemetery, which is part of the Britain Road Cemetery. It's got a Hebrew name that I am not remembering. It's also known as the Stone Road Cemetery because it's on Stone Road. Had somewhere between 16 and 21 headstones vandalized. We went to the scene the day after it was reported, and the cemetery will be preparing an application to restore those headstones with a grant from the Vandalism Fund.
Okay. All right. That's not good news, but...
Would you like me to... I remember now what the bill was. It's a death benefit under workers' comp law. So this increases the maximum that can be paid to a funeral home for a death benefit claim under workers' comp.
Increases the minimum, doesn't it? Doesn't it say no
right.
less than?
That the maximum charges and fees shall not be... Right. Well,
it guarantees them that much.
It raises the ceiling.
Right. Okay. Gotcha.
That answers the question.
But only for workers' comp cases.
Correct. A claim under workers'
because
comp.
Because one issue that we've been seeing more of is that cemeteries are increasingly reluctant to take social services cases because of the low amounts that they're getting for them. But this is just comp.
This
doesn't affect any
comp.
Social service payments.
Right.
Okay. Very good. Remember, you worked a little solid there.
Yeah. Another sip of coffee.
All right. Chad, how are we doing with vandalism these days?
Yes. For the fiscal year ending March 31st, 2017, vandalism fees collected were $150,227. Applications granted totaled $929,884. Applications pending totaled $424,768. Of the applications granted, 6 were for vandalism, 35 were for restoration, and 3 were for abandonment.
Very good. I have a question on that report. On the pending applications, I know that there are one from 2013, one from 2014, and one from 2015. I'm wondering what's going on with that.
Didn't we discuss this last month? There,
all three.
I
did hit the minutes. I'll
defer to Mike in a minute, but
maybe it wasn't last month. It might have been 2 months ago.
My understanding is the applications are submitted to us, and then once they come under review, we're looking to obtain all the information to make a complete application, one of the biggest stumbling blocks of getting the two estimates for repair in some instances. There might be other concerns, so.
Specific ones are available.
Skyward Lake?
One was an abandonment to the town, and we've been waiting on something from the town for years.
There's two abandonments, one is South Champion and one is DeWitt.
Two of the town ones, actually, I don't believe that they should be on there because they were not public cemeteries. So I can either put it together and submit it to the board or continue.
We should just reject.
Well, they're not public cemeteries, they're not qualified. So that, I was going to bring that up because it seems to me that you have those two abandonments, but your explanation with the other that you're waiting for something means to me that the application is not complete.
Right.
So you may want, when you have that situation, you may want to think about not putting this on at all. What you're doing then is recording just that you have received an application. You deem it incomplete say, we need more stuff.
Right.
Well, guess what? It's an incomplete application. Maybe it shouldn't make the chart. Just think about it.
I'll consider that, but if this represents application that we received and are not yet complete, you won't see them. You won't see this report.
Well, I think what the board is suggesting is they don't want to see what a report
on things that are not complete. You don't have it yet.
Because some of them may never be complete. What we have discussed in the past was if a certain amount of time, which we've never decided on how much, but if a certain amount of time passes, we'll just administratively reject them without prejudice to resubmission.
That's a good point.
The only wrinkle with that would be for vandalism. If you were to reject one on vandalism, there's a timeliness issue there. When the resubmitted thing would be too late. But I don't, honestly, I've never seen this happen with a vandalism application. This is typically either an abandonment or more likely dangerous monuments.
It's just a matter of reflecting the numbers as accurately as you can on the report. I mean, what's really pending and what isn't. We'll have further conversations.
Waiting for something from the cemetery.
In case I do circulate the pending report with the investigators to kind of clarify which ones should be on and not.
Paul just asked about
Skyler Lake. Was incomplete.
Right.
We contacted them and they never got back.
Exactly. Right. So you ought to reject.
And that's a dangerous monuments application, right?
Yes.
So
we can follow up with
that.
We can just deny it without prejudice to resubmission.
Just to be clear though, if municipality is requesting funds for an abandoned cemetery and they can't provide a certificate of incorporation or proof that it was public, then that shouldn't make its way to the board. That
there's no reason for it to be because it's facially deficient. Okay. That was actually a beneficial conversation. Thank you, Paul.
So now we have some applications.
Fund applications. So,
Do you want to start with Vestal? Because that's a continuation of one that we had on last time.
Sure. So last time we approved a piece of it, $1,300 or something like that. This is the balance. The only thing that I know from this is that we actually, unusually, because of the cost of replacing the marble uprights, we both quotes came in with flush markers for six of the repairs. And I note that it's not all that expensive, right? Here, on this one?
For the flush markers?
Yeah.
Right.
How come? Because we have another one, the same package. This is why, it's very expensive.
Mm-hmm.
How come it's so cheap here?
It's an easy cemetery to access. It's completely flat terrain. It's very close to where the contractors are located. There'd be no difficulty in getting machinery in.
Yeah, they were moving. These are obelisks or something. They were very big marble.
They were not tablets, but slightly thicker than tablets.
All right.
Would the cemetery have the option to put marble monuments if they wanted to pay for them?
If they can afford it.
I suppose they would.
They can afford it.
Would they then get the credit of the bronze?
I have no problem with them doing it that way.
I don't see any
legal issue there.
I mean, I think...
In this case, they're not going to do that.
No.
Oh, no.
But if they felt, if that would happen, is if the board felt that it was appropriate to go with a less expensive route, and the cemetery, notwithstanding, said we prefer to, we understand, but we prefer to do something fancier, and I suppose they could. I have, you know, it's a trespass issue, right? Is yeah. What is the cemetery entitled to do because the exception is made for them going on and really affecting the repairs by virtue of the statute? But I think it would be all right.
I think it's a very unlikely hypothetical because I think that in most cases, if the cemetery felt very strongly that it had a good reason for putting uprights, you know, it's a historical section, what have you, we would advocate for a payment from the fund yeah. for the higher amount anyway.
Yeah, that's true.
So,
but in the event,
it seems unlikely that there'd be a case where we weren't behind paying more to do uprights and the cemetery said, no, we're doing uprights anyway. It could happen. I mean, we've had a couple in the past year where it was more expensive to do uprights, and
sure.
nevertheless recommended it because they were in historic sections
yes.
and it would look horrible.
All right, so moving on then, unless we have another question on Destel.
So is the $3,200 for the repair of two?
It's the repair of two and the replacement of six. Total eight monuments.
This is a paragraph, the third, the last paragraph says another contractor would need to be sought if an additional bid is required. Is that not referring to the other six?
That paragraph is referring to the marble, if
the
they
marble.
Were going to be replaced with the marble.
Thank you.
My only other comment goes to Hartland Cemetery.
Can I ask one more question?
Oh, sure.
I noticed in the police report, where visitors were there late at night playing Pokemon Go. They've had an issue with several visitors late at night playing Pokemon Go. Is there any way for New York State to prohibit the use of cemeteries for playing games like Pokemon Go?
Cemeteries can go on Pokemon Go. I reported on this about 6 months ago. Cemeteries can go on Pokemon Go's website and ask to be removed as a poke stop or whatever they're called. And what they do is they disable. So if you were to go, if they do that, you would go into the cemetery. You wouldn't find any of the characters that you're trying to collect, and people wouldn't go in. Cemeteries themselves obviously have a right to say you cannot come in and play this, but the most effective way is to keep just turn it off.
Do they all know that? Do they have that option? Or
I put that out there through our meeting. Dave, did you send that? I think you said that to
me. I know a lot of cemeteries have had difficulty getting removed. All the Catholic cemeteries.
If you keep on them,
the
they eventually will.
Diocese have been removed because they got some sort of special. I don't know if the bishop or whoever contacted the Pokemon folks and got all of those cemeteries removed. I know that the regulated cemeteries in my area especially have had trouble
with the Pokemon people. Should New York State be doing something collectively to ban
me? Well, that would be legislation. I mean, each cemetery regulatorily can do what it wants to do. Whether or not it can enforce that is another question. But you're talking about legislation, which is difficult. But also, I would see great difficulty in distinguishing, unless you just said Pokemon Go, in distinguishing games. I mean, as people may be perfectly appropriate, you know, in the old view of cemeteries being a place where there's community and congregation to do things. And so I anticipate that being difficult legislation, not to say that it isn't a good idea, No, I think actually the more practical approach would be, I didn't realize the cemetery is having issues. I mean, Lewis, you could do the same thing that the diocese did. I mean, you can contact, if you find that there are many cemeteries who have difficulty getting off that, there's an avenue, maybe that's a call from you.
I thought I had found another number for them to call to like go
okay.
to the next level.
All right, that's a good point.
I suppose it was a cemetery in your area. It was Peter Pappas I spoke to about it.
Okay. I believe they did get removed.
Yes, they did.
Very good. Let's move on. Hartwick. The only thing that I saw, there was a line there that said no police report was available. What does that mean? The police wouldn't give it to them?
That is correct.
They filed a complaint.
They did contact the police.
the police were the ones that actually took the pictures that were provided, but they wouldn't provide the report to them.
Very odd. I don't know what to say. Okay.
My question is, if they hadn't received these donations, they would have received more money from the, from us? Mm-hmm. Is that true?
Yep. Because that's $2,300. The community is interested, which is important, actually, and important in terms of my question, because this one, this is one of those where flush granite markers were also in play, but we didn't, did we get a quote on that? I don't think we did on this one.
This is Hartwood.
This is Hartwood. Because for Hartwood, we've got 32.
We generally don't request
right.
for flush granite if it's vandalism. But the issue with this...
I got you. Yes.
Specifically with this...
They had damaged stones.
They determined that the stones that were vandalized were in such poor shape to begin with that they... That this was actually broken into two applications. The original application was to repair the kind of the quick ones.
Right.
And then this is for the...
You're talking about Vestal?
No, this is Hartwick.
Oh, okay.
For the repair of foundations.
Okay.
So I suppose, actually, considering that we're treating it as hazardous monuments, we could have requested that.
I suppose I should know the answer to this, but how do you have foundations damaged by vandalism anyway?
Well, the problem
that
is...
That seems highly unusual.
They could have been reset, but then they would have been reset on substandard foundations, and then they would have been in need of further remediation under the hazard.
So wasn't that the foundations were damaged, just that the foundations... while they might have been good enough to keep the stone standing up and for them not to be dangerous, aren't good enough to hold
right.
a reset
stone. Before the vandalism occurred, these particular ones on this application would have been eligible for hazardous monument money.
I had a question on the application. It indicated when it was signed by the cemetery official in November that proof of completed work for a prior application had not been received by the division. Has that been corrected?
Yes, I did receive the completed invoice, and I did inspect the repairs.
And I just want to let the board know that I'm working with the division to come up with language in the legal notices for all future vandalism right claims, because we're starting to see a number of vandalism claims where the contractor is suggesting replacement rather than repair, which moves it into the hazardous monument, which requires a different kind of notice. So we're trying to put that notice language in all vandalism.
I'm of the opinion that what a warranted replacement is repair. But it's good to make it clear.
Yeah. Mike, on your recommendation sheet, you recommend approval in the amount of $29,022. And I don't think that includes the $235.95 for publication of the legal notice.
That was already paid, I believe.
We split it.
Application.
The original application was for $55. Mm. And so they did the legal notice at the time. And so we're saying that that legal notice is still
right.
good.
Okay. Any further discussion on... these applications? Okay. Have a motion?
I'll move to approve all of the vandalism and hazardous
applications. That's great. Second?
Mrs. Duke Scamper?
Yes.
Did you have a comment on Dover? Yeah, East Guilford, Rush Pond, and Park. All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Sorry. One more thing on the subject of vandalism. I should have mentioned this in connection with the Stone Road vandalism in Rochester. A friend of mine actually contacted me who lives in Rochester and was trying to get a group of
people together to go over to the cemetery the next day and put headstones back up. Please do not attempt this at home.
Yeah.
This is a task best left to the professionals.
It's great to see the community spirit, though.
If the community, right, as the cemetery said, if you want to help the cemetery, please consider making a donation to the cemetery. To the extent that donation is earmarked for repairs, then that might very well reduce the grant to us, but you don't have to earmark it for that. There was a video circulating of the Jewish cemetery in Philadelphia that was vandalized, of people putting stones back up, and I don't know what was involved there. I sincerely hope they were all working under the guidance of a trained monument dealer or someone who knows something about what they were doing. But please, 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 if you're watching out there, don't try this at home. Yeah. Leave it to the professionals.
Very good for your public service announcement. Thank you. All right, moving on to Kensico.
Kensico's next? Okay.
Division, why don't you present?
Sure. So Kensico has a parcel of land. We approved the development of it back in 2010. They now want to build a garden community mazo on the site with niche space as well. The the geography of the area is such that there is a lake, the view of which is a significant selling point for the cemetery. In-ground burials in this area would not have a view of the lake. Once once you're in the mausoleum and you're raised off the ground, the lake would be visible from the crypt space, which apparently, even though the people in the crypts are obviously not going to be looking at the lake, is a selling point. Where's the rate of return calculation here? And more or less, the cemetery anticipates clearing $8 million on the deal. Leaving aside, that I'll flag this since other people have mentioned this, that does not leave aside any funds for future maintenance of the mausoleum. I'll note, however, this is different from the mausoleums that we've seen that have
problems. Yeah, the luxury of having two in front of us, so.
The advantage of this one, the comparison of this one, this is just as different from those structures in that this is a garden mausoleum. It does not have any indoor space. It's not going to have any utilities in it. It's not, there's no in it. It's just a structure into which caskets are slid and crypt covers are put on.
So you can anticipate the maintenance.
Obviously, the maintenance cost will be less. That doesn't mean there won't be any, but they will be significantly less than you would not anticipate, even if the cemetery lacked funds, that this could experience the type of problems that either Whispering Maples or any of the other problematic indoor mausoleums we've seen have experienced.
So I've got a question.
Also, Kensico doesn't have any above ground mausoleum space, really. The one they had is sold out.
Right. So in the projected revenue and expenses, I see that there is $1,775 in selling expenses, representing about 15%. What's that relate to? Do you know? I don't know. Bet you Kensico is here and tell us.
I'd rather they elaborate on that.
Sure.
So,
how are you?
I'm good.
Yeah, nice to see you.
Good to see you. What it relates to.
Why don't you identify yourself for posterity?
Ray Quinnell, president of Kensico. So the 15% was an attempt to estimate what our sales expenses would be in terms of our sales team, our sales force, marketing efforts, and actually we think we probably were conservative in giving me that number. So we have a history of kind of what our sales expenses are over the years, and most of the years of the last decade, you'll see the expenses come in at 12% or less. So we kind of beefed it up to just be conservative.
And so you have a permanently employed sales force?
Yes. Four permanently employed sales folks, manager, vice president, and three.
And they're selling not just this
selling, product, selling.
So it's 12% of the total.
Of the reserve sale.
And I'm picking your brain. Not for necessarily for purposes related directly to your application. What's the total sales, total sales that you have?
Well,
I should have that here.
Yeah, it's.
That's in here.
It's in one of my letters I gave Louis, but last year was Ken's Jewelry Festival. We had almost 12 million sales. If you take.
Yeah, we don't have 15, 16, and 16, and 15 and 14. They had just under 11 million
in
sales.
I have right here. Absolutely. Okay.
Wait, what did you have for 16 though? Because we don't have that.
16 was
12.
Just short of 12 million.
So you're up. So this is good.
Yeah. All right. Well, Mr. Pinnell is here. Any questions?
Sure. Your board minutes don't reflect that there was a quorum question.
I'd say
your board minutes don't reflect that there was a quorum present.
Well, I just gave you the resolution out of the minutes, but there was 100% attendance if you want me to verify that.
No, that's fine. And how many board members are there?
There are 9 board members.
And can you tell me how much each director is getting paid and each officer?
Well, the directors who are not officers are paid approximately $33,000. The officers, there's a chairman of the board who's, again, approximately $70,000. There's a secretary vice chairman who's approximately $45,000.
The other thing I should note for the record, sorry, is that that our recommendation for approval is approval contingent on receipt of local approvals, and we do not have a complete stamped set of plans from an engineer or architect, so it would be contingent on us receiving that at a later date as well.
And I can, on the local approvals, we've had meetings with the folks at the town of Mount Pleasant, and we will need a building permit. We need to amend our stormwater management plan that we put in back in 2010 when you all approved this parcel, among others, being developed. And we need a couple of public hearings on the site plan. So we've got that all kind of worked out with the town. We're hopeful that all gets done in April and May and June, and the projected start date is July.
Are you changing the grading with this project? Is it going to change the stormwater, the drainage?
Very little.
Okay.
Very little. And part of the reason, we're not really changing the grading. But when you put in these huge foundations, it will change somewhat. But the nice thing is, as Louis was mentioning, there's a pond, we call it a pond, very close to where this is going to be. And so the runoff will just come into the pond and feed into the plant that's already been developed. So, but we have to make a few adjustments.
The other question I have is your assets. Your description of your accounts are different from what I've normally seen. Can you tell me what they are?
Sure. So you're looking at the sheet there.
You mean the declaratory maintenance fund?
You've got a bequest. Yes, that's
okay.
So
our bequest.
No. There's bequest and endowment principal fund, bequest endowment surplus,
okay.
PM fund, declaratory maintenance fund, general.
Sure.
Two out of those I know.
Okay.
Well, I think I know.
The request and endowment principal and income fund.
That's PC, right?
Those are our PCs, yes.
Okay.
The permanent maintenance fund, obviously, you know. Okay, the one that we have that nobody else has is the declaratory maintenance fund. That came about because Kensico was sued in the 1930s by ranch owners. And the ranch owners were concerned that they weren't going to get a proper return on their ranchers at the dividends. A consequence, an outgrowth of that lawsuit, was Kensico agreed to take certain funds and put them in a segregated fund, which is not to be used under the court ruling until essentially Kensico sells out, which, by the way, is probably not for another 100 years. So what has happened is, since the 30s, that original fund has built up because no money has been taken out of that fund for anything to the sum you see now. And so the anticipation is that when Kensico gets to a point where it's totally sold out, it'll probably just plop into the permanent maintenance fund and then
And then on the revenue side, you have a line, bequests and endowments received. It's always in the neighborhood of around 300,000.
Okay.
Those are annual bequests?
That's PC.
That's the PC part. That's PC part. Right. But included there, every once in a while we do get requests. Somebody leaves us a request in the will.
Okay.
Those are contributions to the PC.
It's money moving into the PC fund.
Yes.
Okay. And that's why it shows up as income.
Yes.
Why would that go to the general fund?
Well, what goes into the general fund is essentially what revenue you take in minus all your expenses and the contributions to the permanent maintenance fund. So that's essentially what goes into the general fund. So.
What are these land sales?
Land share certificates?
Yeah.
Well, when the cemetery was originally organized back in the late 1800s, they went around and made deals with the people who owned the property in the area, and they said, okay, you sell us the land. We don't have any money to pay until we sell lots or lot owners. So we'll give you a land share certificate that says you participate basically in the proceeds that we receive when we sell off the lots. So there were 30,000 of these issued by Kensico. And over the years, Kensico has been in a program to buy them all back. We now own them all back with the exception of 60. So we have 60 out of 30,000 that two brothers who live in New Hampshire own, who we've been actively trying to get them to sell back to us so we can close this. They don't want them. Every year they get a little distribution from us because they're selling.
I commend you on acquiring them.
Yes,
I commend you on acquiring them.
Well, thank you. It's a program that went on for quite some time.
Usually we see the opposite. They acquire you.
Well, exactly.
Question on,
yes.
On the standard form of agreement between the owner and the design builder. I know it's a piece of information. It's not there. It's a guaranteed maximum price.
Well, the price is set. The contract is confusing, but there's an addendum to the contract that gives you the price.
I didn't see, I'm sure it's there, I didn't see an annualized projected revenue and expense sheet.
Well, we didn't give you an annualized, we just gave you the total. All right. The projected total.
But that's our bad for not dividing it.
I was about to say
it,
but I'll talk to you about that.
It's hard to obviously project how many years over the future. So,
right.
But the total projected revenue is close to 12 million.
I think it's 10 years, 15 years.
Yeah, I think we would probably say.
Sold out the
other one. Yeah, the
a
only
long
thing.
Time ago, right?
A long time ago, the only space we have left in the other one, we keep a couple of crypts vacant for situations where you have to have a temporary storage or something.
All right, so my comment to the division is let's, because there's a lot of inconsistency I notice every time I look at an application. And for me, it's hard because I need it up front. Could we just every time have the revenue expense sheet for the cemetery, generally, that's additional repairs, the projected revenue and expenses on an annualized basis for 10 years, along with the payback, if there's a loan or anything like that, or to themselves. The typical stuff, but let's put it, if we could, behind the division recommendation first, before we get to the cemetery's application proper. That way, it's just right there.
Okay.
Those are two most important things to me. That'd be great. Thank you. Any further questions?
You actually have that here. The problem is that Vinny didn't do a annualized.
Yeah, return. Yeah. But we almost always do. You know, so I'm looking for it, and I find it valuable. So. Especially when we're talking payback.
Yep.
All right. Any further discussion on Kensico?
Not for me.
Okay. On a motion?
I'll move to approve this application.
Contingent on all necessary.
Receipt of local approvals and division receipt of a stamped set of plans. Division review of a stamped set of plans.
Receipt
I have no. review. I don't have any place to keep the rolled sets, so I'm happy to look at the Ray's office instead.
Is that okay?
It's perfect.
Okay. One second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Very good. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Good job.
Hit the road before they think of something.
Yeah, right.
They know where to find me, Louis.
Indeed, I do.
Port Crane Cemetery, land purchase.
This got tabled for want of an appraisal, of appraisals.
And you got a $5,000 one.
We got a single appraisal.
Right.
It was pulling teeth.
And they said, oh, it sounds about right. That was...
No, they actually did a proper appraisal.
Yeah. I just love that it came out to the selling price as well.
They also had somebody, they also now have local approval on the sale.
Oh, that's good. Okay. We must have discussed this last time. I just don't recall. They are picking up some existing burial ground.
Right. That they themselves have been maintaining.
They've been maintaining. How big is that? I mean, what's
and how much of it's got burials on it?
How much of the parcel has burials on it?
Yeah, the 0.9 acres.
About a third.
About a third?
Under our purview?
No, it's not. It's church.
But it's indistinguishable from the cemetery, so they've been taking care of it.
The cemetery, as we articulated last time, the cemetery feels that they have to take care of it because people who pass it on the road think that is the cemetery, and if that were to fall into a disrepair, nobody would buy it from them.
All right, so that's a rationale. I'm a little, they're essentially donating. It's been donating, is that right? Their
yes,
that's correct.
Maintenance efforts to the church, to the Methodist Church that owns the cemetery, and they're not getting anything for that.
Right. So all of our laws, rules, and regulations will apply to this purchase.
Absolutely.
Property with those.
They don't they don't anticipate doing any new interments in the part that's got interments.
No, I'm looking at the $5,000 figure and saying, well, wait a minute, they're assuming, even though they've been doing it all these years, I suppose, they're still assuming responsibility and liability for this. Why wouldn't the sales price reflect that?
We've been down that road. The church is not willing to budge.
Okay. I don't recall.
We told them, we had them go back to the church with the directive saying the state cemetery board thinks you should be paying them to take this land off their hands. And the church said, not on your nelly. We're not doing it for free.
Well, they had church before, but the church was still up. They hadn't taken it down. And I don't remember. I know we resolved it. I don't remember how.
We mean separate and apart from
the Methodist Conference.
This is separate and apart from this application.
This was another cemetery.
Yes, I remember that now.
They tend to be...
They're watching the bottom line.
Brendan, you said that that legal fees were covered, but not legal fees of the buyer, right?
Right.
So it's really a $6,000 deal if you threw that stuff in.
I don't know of any... I think possibly... some of that is just being donated, the legal fees. I know they've got a lawyer that's very closely associated with the president. So.
Okay. How's the financial outlook of the cemetery?
I mean, they've got plenty of money, and they've got...
$5,000 does not represent...
Not at all.
There is a fiscal, it's just not attached.
Yeah, I didn't.
A fiscal.
It was the back page.
Yeah, the back page got detached from us for some reason.
Their last total balance was $834,409. They incurred some losses in the last year that Andrew looked at, but that was based on equipment purchases and the construction of a fence. Other than that, they've had proceeds in the neighborhood of $20,000 to $25,000 each year.
All right. Their view, which I think is correct, is that they really have no alternative but to do this. Because
well, they want. I understand. Look, there's very good reasons. They get frontage, they get another entrance.
And they have downside risk.
They ensure that it's developed for cemetery purposes and not residential structures. Okay, understand.
Now, are you guys going to have to wait in on this?
Yeah.
Because the church is selling property.
Yeah.
This is a Binghamton establishment.
Yes, it'd be Mike Danaher's issue, not yours.
That's a contingency, of course, as well.
Right.
Right, on AG approval. All necessary approvals. All right, any further discussion?
Do you have a form for the approval?
Oh, my goodness, that's right.
Yes.
We have our special land purchase.
All right.
I'm not sure which version might be appropriate.
Oh, really? You're giving me two different choices?
Yep.
Thanks so much. So one is contingent upon all municipal government approvals. Are there any for this purchase?
Yeah, it's just going to be the AG.
Right, that's good. All right.
The town is already approved, so.
And this language I
seller also has to get
supposed
approval.
To be in there.
I miss some.
That not necessarily.
This petition is to the Supreme Court.
Yeah, but I thought the Revitalization Act changed that.
Oh, no, this is a religious corporation.
Okay, you're good.
It did.
So okay. They don't have to go to the Supreme Court.
They appear to be doing it.
Okay. So, yeah, I think that's the appropriate language.
Because it isn't a petition.
You want me to read it out?
They might have filed not you.
Yeah. Want to make this motion?
The reason there's a petition is because this was so old that it was before we could just have them approved here.
Yeah. Since I'm going to read it, I'll make the motion.
Yeah.
It says, so formal, my goodness. Right. By application dated 9/1/17, the Port Crane Cemetery Association, Broome County, cemetery number 04-025, request the Cemetery Board approval to purchase real property for $5,000. The Cemetery Board has reviewed the application reports and appraisals and has determined that the agreed upon price for the real property does not exceed its fair and reasonable market value. Cemetery Board approves the purchase, including the price to be paid and the method of payment, contingent upon receipt of all required municipal and governmental approvals. Request is approved. That's my motion.
I'll second that motion,
yeah,
Chairman.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Good job, motion writer. Here, throw me your pen, too.
So Beverly Hills has been tabled to next month because of the rescheduling of this meeting because of the snowstorm. One of the board members of the cemetery couldn't attend today, and they definitely want to be heard by the board. So when we
How
get to schedule,
how many board members is coming?
I believe just one of their board members is coming, but we'll discuss when we get to scheduling. We'll discuss that. So that is not on the agenda for today.
Okay.
Which means your board packet is about 50% lighter.
Can we get a copy of their bylaws and conflict of interest statement?
Absolutely. That should not. I think we actually have it. I'll check. Certainly the conflict of interest statements I have.
There you go, Jeff.
Thank you.
Okay. So that brings us to Woodlawn.
Woodlawn indeed, major renovation.
Okay, yeah, this is a very simple one.
This?
Yeah, Woodlawn Cemetery is one of four cemeteries in New York City. Well, yeah, one of four cemeteries in New York City that has a crematory. They have four retorts. They date from 1977. They are very old. They require a lot of repairs and are operating at capacity. Indeed, I went to the cemetery a few months ago. We got a call from a funeral director who said something to the effect of, what's going on with Woodlawn? Why were they shut down? Like, shut down by who? I didn't shut them down. So I went out there, and it turns out they've had two retorts that were down for repairs. And those they've had two reports down for repairs on and off for the last few months. So Woodlawn's long been considering replacing those retorts or ultimately moving its crematory to another site. But because of where they're at with the state of their facility, they feel they can't wait any longer. They want to scrap the entire existing hardware down there in the crematory, replace the four existing retorts with three facultative retorts that burn cheaper and cleaner and more efficiently and more quickly. frankly rushed to get this on your agenda because they've been down so often that it's really creating a capacity issue for New York City and not just for the cemetery itself.
And the total price
is about $1.5 million. It's $1.1 million for the actual for the three retorts, for the installation, for construction work associated with that. Another $224,000 in anticipated maintenance over the next 10 years, which is budgeted into their return on investment or repayment schedule. And they have an existing line of credit from Putnam County Savings Bank, which they propose to finance this using, so that adds an interest cost of $236,000. They anticipate paying this thing off in roughly 8.5 years. They're going to be saving $59,000 a year in utility costs, and I don't remember the exact number, but their maintenance will even conservatively be half what it would otherwise be for the existing retorts. Plus, they'll be increasing capacity somewhat.
Have you had discussion with the cemetery with respect to why they're seeking a line of credit and this and paying interest?
I have not had the opportunity to ask them that. Although at 4%, I'm sure they can
do it. Hi, good morning. How are you?
Good. I'm Mitch Rose, president of Woodlawn. Thank you, Lewis, as well, for getting this on the agenda so quickly. Is this okay to stand here?
Anywhere you like.
Easier to see. So anyway, we have a unsecured line with Putnam County Savings Bank. They hold $200,000 of our money, which we can take back. And they've offered, given the circumstances of this particular instance, since it's strictly equipment, largely, they've given us this opportunity to finance it in that manner.
Is there anything you do with the business? And is there any reason why you're not funding it directly for revenue?
Well, what I did in the model for payback was funded through, as Lewis pointed out, the repair improvements, because our equipment is 40 years old. They're actually not even retorts, they're inline cremators, in contrast to retorts, which are far more fuel efficient. And in addition, because they're inline cremators, the rebricking expense has just become exorbitant over the course of time. In fact, last year we were shut down so many times over the course of the entire year that we figured out we're not only losing the rebricking and the replacement of the interior, we're also losing business because many of our funeral directors are choosing other facilities, and that's what prompted Lewis, I think, initially to come down to see that. But at this point, I feel comfortable that we'll be paying the loan back sooner than the 8.75.
What's your return on investment overall, ballpark?
Well,
not on this. No, just in general. What are you making in your investments annually?
So we spend it's roughly $1 million annual revenue business. We perform 2,500.
No. No. So here's where I'm going with this. Where I'm going with this is, are you making more money in the market than the 4% you're going to be paying in interest? Because that's one very good reason why you would do it.
With the caveat that past results don't predict.
Of course.
When you put labor costs into it and then the equipment costs, we're probably on the order of about a 15% to 20% return.
No.
So let me ask a question.
You want to try it?
I raised this issue with Division. I want to raise it here. You're incurring, assuming your payback is on the line of credit takes the 8+ years, over $200,000 in interest. It would seem to make more financial sense to take the money out of your general fund or your PM fund or some combination rather than pay that interest expense, unless, as Lewis is trying to indicate, you're making more than 4% on that money, and you expect to continue to make more than 4%. But the other issue I have with this is it's a variable rate loan, and it's 4% now. This thing can go up, and we've gotten indications that interest rates are going to go up. So how does this make the most financial sense for the cemetery?
Well, I think with the improvement in the gains in the new equipment in terms of operating efficiency, we'll gain that 4% over and above.
But you gain that whether you take the money out of PM or
irrespective of how you finance it.
Oh, okay. Right,
so the question is, because we're
so you're thinking more some combination of, there's no prepayment penalty on the loan.
So if interest rates were to go way up,
right,
you could just pay the whole thing off,
yes,
and say...
And we are tied to the LIBOR, which is a little different. Over history, that certainly is more standardized.
So you say there's no prepayment penalty. That means there's no minimum you have to keep on the line of credit.
No.
That if you want to pay it off tomorrow, if you take it out, you pay it off, as long as you still get this one day of rent.
That's correct.
And the other question I had about this was, I mean, I often see with charities that the bank they do business with has a board member on.
Oh yeah, I got, sorry, Tony, I didn't have a chance to send that to you. I got it late last night. I have a statement from them that there are no relationships between the bank and anyone at Woodlawn.
Okay. All right, great. That's good to know.
Sorry, I got it like at 8 o'clock last night.
But to go back to the original question, so in terms of your investment portfolio, what is your return right now on that?
On our overall portfolio?
Yeah.
Well, the income and dividends and interest portion is, I believe, around 4.5%, somewhere in that.
So right now you're coming out ahead by borrowing the money.
That's what you're
saying. And if it were to change materially, you could simply make the decision then to pay it off.
Yeah.
I mean, the reason I thought financing, wasn't troubled by financing it per se, is even though the cemetery obviously has a lot of money, $5 million in general fund for a cemetery this size isn't a huge amount of money, and to plop down 1.1 of that at one point gives them a little less of a cushion than I think we or they would be happy with.
Well, the only thing I would add, just so we're clear on the facts, the permanent maintenance fund actually went down in 2015. So that means the additions to the fund weren't enough to offset losses. It went from $36 million to $34 million from 2014 to 2015. So I don't know if that 4.5%, whether that's a reasonable assumption going forward.
I know we had gains in 2016, although
okay,
I can't speak to them right off the top of my head.
from what we've seen on cemetery financials, December 31st, 2015, it seems to have been a terrible place to take a snapshot of where people
right.
were. Who do you have your money with?
Fiduciary Trust is our custodian, and then there's a variety of, then IPEX is our investment management firm, and then they utilize a variety of money markets,
gotcha,
and various funds.
So I'm taking this opportunity to learn a little bit. I ask Ken some of the same questions. But the commissions that you list, all right, works out to about 16.5%, something like that, of the revenue. Do you employ full-time folks, or do you?
Yes, we have 8 full-time staff that sell cemetery property, as well as a sales manager who manages that staff.
And is that 16.6, whatever it is that across the board, pretty much a percentage?
Yes. Yes. And it goes up and down over the course of time as well. We pay less commission on various products compared to others. And also we tend to have a fairly high pre-need ratio. So we pay a little more for pre-need because the counselors are directly involved in that marketing themselves as well compared to immediate needs.
What are other administrative expenses?
Repairs and maintenance fall in there to some extent.
That's another thing I got late last night.
Yeah.
Their answer on other administrative expenses was that their repairs and maintenance doubled. They had to replace some vehicles. And contract services, since that was another question, their landscaping is outsourced. It's approximately $975,000 per year.
I think I also asked about the fringe benefits.
That and the sales income I thought would be the best driver. Yes.
So fringes? Fringe benefits? How come so high?
I know over the course of time they continue to go up. I mean, we have, in terms of our benefit package for employees, we have both the EPO and the HMO, about, I think, 22%. Covered by the company and 78% by the employees.
Just something
that's not. And it's not 100% because you're looking just at wages versus
right.
A fringe. It's wages plus salaries versus fringe.
Oh. Okay, so the, yes, you're right.
It's still, it's still relatively high, but.
Yeah, well, you know, that's a lot different. That's a lot. Okay. Much more comfortable.
And then, I don't know if this should be addressed to you or to Lewis, division, but, on your, I believe the cemetery prepared the projections, of the payoff.
Yes.
Payback. It shows, increase in revenue, decrease in fuel, decrease in repairs. And it shows annually a decrease in repair of $76,000, which is what you have been, you report as your annual repair cost. So this indicates to me that you're projecting zero repair costs.
No, because they have another line on top, estimated scheduled maintenance.
Yeah, I can address
that.
Oh,
okay.
As the $76,000 was a three-year average over the last 3 years. It was actually higher, I believe, last year. But in that being said, we took that average. And as far as the zero repair costs, this is largely due to the equipment itself. The new equipment that will go in will perform between 2,500 cremations up to 3,000 before you even do any rebricking. Our equipment hits about 600, and we have to rebrick, refloor. So that is going to be part of the savings that was projected in there.
To reduce,
we will not have to do any immediate repair. But I did put in that appendix the first point where we'll do the floor. I forget off the top of my head. It's the first.
The 24,000.
Yes.
Okay.
All the floors. All right. And then the next projected piece is when they reach approximately 6,000 cremations. At that point, you do the floors as well as a total rebuild.
Okay. All right.
So we put that into it. As a second, you know, as a scheduled maintenance item.
Okay.
And then the line above it is strictly the cost of the equipment.
Right, because it's new equipment, they're not going to be maintaining it every year. They're going to, at least for the first 10 years, they're going to have periodic maintenance instead.
And the equipment's going essentially the same spot as where the existing equipment was. The chapel area, as it's set up, actually has a roof that was designed to be removed and have the equipment lifted right out, and then the new equipment will go right back in.
And since we had a call this morning before our meeting concerning everyone's favorite crematory in Erie County and emissions therefrom or not therefrom, I'll note that these with the filtration equipment attached to the quotative retorts, there's probably an argument that the air that's coming out at the end is actually cleaner than the ambient air.
Yes.
This is incredible clean technology.
The need for the retort is clear. The retort is clear.
We're really.
Originally, I actually discouraged them from doing this. I wanted them. They ultimately want to build a new crematory that's going to maybe have another retort and be more of a space where they can bring families in if they want to see the body loaded into the retort. But they just can't wait.
The line of credit is going to be used for what?
We're going to use it for the equipment purchase, and we anticipate the equipment to be just under $1 million. And then, really, we're lifting the roof off, we're craning out the existing equipment, craning in the new equipment, and then some fabrication pieces associated with the site itself.
And you're going to deal with DOB?
But not for anticipated maintenance.
What's that?
The line of credit.
Not for anticipated maintenance is the question.
No, we're going to use it strictly for the project. Okay. We've done the estimate at $1.1 million. It could come in a little less than that. But that's where we're at with it at this point. That's our estimate based on the engineers involved, certainly the equipment cost, which is proposed in the plan itself. There's little, there's really basically no construction elements to this. It's removal of a roof, which was designed to be removed. And then replacement of the equipment, and then replacement of the existing roof.
One other thing, just for the record, we haven't we did not analyze this under Section 1505A for creation of a new crematory. There is additional capacity being added. They're going from being able to do about 2,500 cases to doing about 3,600 cases. That respect, I'm going to note that. they're serving an area of roughly, was it
10.5?
No, way more than that. I mean, they're over 9.5 million. So 8.5 million in New York City and another million in Westchester who might come to them instead of Ferncliff. And there are five crematories for that 9.5 million person area. So
your point is under any
there is any right there's and there are no other crematories in Bronx County, so
correct. And none of Manhattan, of course.
Correct.
We're the only one in the Bronx. Right.
They in Ferncliff are the only ones in sort of the Bronx Westchester area.
And that was good to address.
Yeah, we continue to see steady increase in demand. It has not slowed down.
Any further questions? Discussion? No. Want to make a motion?
Thank you.
Thank you.
I will move to approve the project, the major renovation replacement of retorts at the Woodlawn Cemetery.
Contingent any municipal or governmental.
Okay.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Wow. Well, we have come to the end of the regular schedule to discuss before executive session. So before opens the floor, we'll set a date. I'd actually remember this time, Paul.
Okay. Date's going to be a little complicated, so let's talk about this. I have exactly two possible dates where in the second and third week of April, where in both Beverly Hills and I can actually be at the meeting.
Okay.
Well, so hopefully you guys can be at one of those.
To us.
The dates are Thursday, April 13th, and Wednesday, April 19th.
I'm good with either one.
One of you guys had a conflict with at least one of those.
Yeah.
And I don't remember which one. Indeed, I think you both had a conflict with them, but it was different ones.
Oh, great.
I know.
So they have
the 19th, I'd have to leave by 1:30.
If that's the issue, then we'll just put Beverly on first, and if there's stuff that's non-controversial, we can do it later.
That's Wednesday.
Yeah.
Friday the 21st didn't work.
Dan didn't want to do it Friday. I'm not sure that the cemetery is available.
So it's the 19th at 10:30.
I'd like to at least consider the possibility of starting at 10 again.
Like you considered this week?
Heck with it. Let's start at 10:30.
No, I'm okay with it.
You're getting me out of bed like at 4 o'clock now.
Let's do a 9 o'clocker.
No.
That's how you
I'll bring
friends.
Bagels.
If you're doing it at 9 o'clock, you're bringing alcohol.
Yeah. Coffee.
Irish coffee.
Yeah.
For the record, that is not permitted in state facilities.
This isn't a state facility. We rent.
All right, so we have it scheduled.
Yeah, done. 4:19 at 10:30.
Very good. All right, so that being done, I'll come to.
You may have my kids at the meeting, but that's another story.
Can't wait. I'll open up to the floor. Anybody like to address the board?
Not to bore you because I fucked it up already, but I just wanted to say a nice thing about the town of Mount Pleasant Police Department. And I don't know if, how many calls that you all have gotten about the whole thing with Jewish cemeteries. You know, Kensico, we had the Sharon Gardens Division exclusively Jewish faith. And so we got a few calls. They asked us about our security, what you've been doing. But the nice thing I wanted to say about the town of Mount Pleasant and spread to other towns is that their police officers actually came and talked to us and said they were running extra patrols through our area, Jewish area, and also across the highway from us is Mount Pleasant and Mount Eden, and they were checking them too, and they were being proactive in trying to make sure that there was some. Okay, and the vandalism was, people understood that they were out there watching and making sure. So I thought that was a good thing. It was a nice interaction between the town and the cemetery. So I just wanted to wish you all.
Good to hear. Did they have any suggestions on anything you guys should be doing differently?
They asked us, and you know, we do have security there, but we don't have it 24 hours. Back in the 70s, we actually did. It was more of a kids causing mischief problem back in the 70s. So, you know, they didn't really have any extra suggestions for us other than, you know, the keeping doing what we're doing. But the problem for Ketchikan in particular is that we're bisected by two public roads. So we don't have control over our borders, really.
And you don't really have high fences with razor wire on top or anything.
No, I mean, we've got these little chains across, so, you know, it's a pretty easy place to get in and out. So it was nice to hear about the police.
Saving up. Okay. We'll give you time. We'll give you the extra time allotted for this week.
Just a reminder, though, seriously, on behalf of ISAC, the Government Legal Affairs Public Affairs Seminar, the 40th annual, is May 8th and 9th at the Hilton, just on the hill, where we've been invited the board to participate. So
I guess our board meeting will be May 8th or 9th.
Sounds good. Makes it easy to schedule. Thank you. All right, I will move to enter into executive session for investigative matters.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Let's take a 5-minute break, then we'll do that. Motion to exit and adjourn.
So move.
But they still.
Okay. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.